Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being here tonight, and welcome to the Hudson Library and Historical Society. My name is Charlotte Plank, and I'm an Emerging Technologies Librarian here at the library. Tonight's program is part of our Spring 2017 Entrepreneurship Series, generously supported by the Burton D. Morgan Foundation. Please feel free to, I know I gave most of you a calendar, but feel free to look that over, and you're always welcome to come back to any of our programs. I just wanted to announce two of our upcoming series events. Tomorrow, Wednesday, February 22nd at 10 a.m., representatives of the Akron office of BVU, the Center for Nonprofit Excellence, will be here to discuss the services they provide to nonprofits, such as referral of board members, pro bono, and direct service volunteers. And then in a week or 2 weeks, we'll have another program on Tuesday, March 7th at 6:30 p.m. We'll be hosting an arts entrepreneurship panel, something new for us. It'll feature Liz Moggins, Executive Director of Zygote Press, Nicole Mullett, Executive Director of Arts Now, and Gabe Pollack, Director of the Bop Stop in Cleveland. They will be here to share their experiences in the field of arts management and entrepreneurship. Our speaker tonight, Cindy Kula, is a graduate of Cleveland State University with a Bachelor of Science in Computer and Information Science. Kula is a frequent speaker to and writer for industry and community groups, trade associations, the OSCPA, and the Lorman Educational Services. She also volunteers for the Plain Dealer Tax Call-In and the OSCPA Fetch Day. Please join me in welcoming Cindy.
Okay, thank you for being here today. I just want to welcome all of you and to let you know this is interactive. This is a small enough crowd, so raise your questions as you have them, because if we wait till the end, sometimes it may not make sense. So feel free to ask questions as we're going along. Okay, tonight, the key word around that you're going to keep hearing me say is planning. Okay, planning is a key word around here, whether it's tax, finances, personal life. It's all about planning. I compare planning to final exams. In college, if you remember taking a final exam, some of the courses that weren't in your area of expertise, you might just have crammed for it. Okay, you spend 4 or 5 hours the night before just cramming for that final exam. Some people do that with planning. And obviously, the information we cram for, we don't retain it. So planning is very, very similar. So the more we plan ahead, 5 years, whatever, the more it'll stick and the better the plan will be. So today we're going to talk a little bit about business planning, going into financial planning, and some tax planning. Last year we addressed, and I don't know if the slides are available, but last year we addressed entity choices and various other information. Those are questions you can raise, but it was discussed last year, so I didn't want to present them again. Okay, so today we're going to talk about small business tax strategies and financial planning tips. Okay, so when you have a business life cycle, you're going to have the startup, the growth, the mature phase of your business, decline and transitioning, but through every life cycle, record keeping is important. And you did receive in their packet a record retention guide. So you should have that available. So the goals and planning tips for each stage. When we start up a business, you have to learn your business. What are you going to do with it? You know, what kind of ideas do you have? And the key with planning is that you have to have a plan. IRS comes into businesses, and remember, they distinguish a business from a hobby. And if you don't have profits 3 out of the last 5 years, they will dub you as a hobby. But if you have a business plan in place and you have these kind of steps involved, they will actually accept it. So it's really important to do the planning so that the IRS doesn't disallow losses from your business. And a prime example is a friend of mine who went into stitchery. She bought this $10,000 sewing machine, knew she was going to do a lot of things with it, but she really didn't have a plan. She just loved doing stitchery. So she kept going on and going on and never generating a profit, writing off the machine. So at some point, she gave up. because she knew she was hitting losses after losses. So once again, you do have to have a plan. Yes.
So as an author, it takes long.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So does that 3 out of 5?
You should probably by the 5th year have a profit though, when you're writing a book. I don't know how long.
50 years?
No. No, and it does happen.
And then even when it sells, you get very small royalties.
Royalties, exactly. But right. And I can honestly say I was in an IRS audit and it was more of a farm venture, but the individual hadn't had profits for 15 years. Okay? And they actually came in, and although they didn't disallow everything, they went through the 9 steps of a hobby versus a for-profit entity, and they gave him 2 nights because he did pass 2 of the 9 tests. So right now, if you do all the right things, they do look at that. And they know that there are certain professions like artwork, artists, you know, that have to take a little bit longer time. So there was one recent court case that said this artist didn't have anything for 10 years, didn't show any profit, but she was allowed the losses because she had everything documented properly. So that's the key. The IRS is not against us. They want to work with us as long as we've developed a plan. So in your startup, you're going to begin to grow, you're going to prepare a business plan, you're going to determine the structure of the business. And those are entity choices. Do you want to be an LLC, an S corp, a C corp, or just try it out for a while as a Schedule C? You have to obtain information on the investment and tax management, and planning once again is essential. It's important to generate cash flow by calling on customers. Okay, then we hit the growth phase. And the goal is to become established business in the respective market. Other goals are to expand the business through capital reinvestment or outside financing, attracting and retaining key employees, providing insurance for your employees and yourself and employee benefit plans, and maintaining a cash reserve. And when we get to the maturity stage, we can't get too complacent. Okay, we've got the business going, we're going right along, but we don't want to get complacent. We want to keep going to adapt to a changing environment. There are times that technology changes the whole new business. You know, in the olden days, people sewed and they used a regular sewing machine. Now they have the ones where you just program it and make this. I mean, we have cars that are driving themselves now. So we have to adjust to a changing environment. And we have to stay competitive and innovative. And researching a project or researching your area is key because you do want to stay competitive. You want to keep up with the new ideas in your area of expertise. You have to review budgets and make sure you have a budget. What is it going to cost you to do this? Because half the time people are just going by the seat of their pants and they don't know exactly what it's going to cost. And there are projections out there, there are budgets out there for various areas of businesses that you can just research on the internet. Important to monitor expenses against what the budget you expected to pay. Shouldn't be any surprises, and I know people who have businesses and they end up giving me a shoebox or a big brown paper bag at the end, so I know they don't know what's going on. You know, they don't know where their expenses are. You have to enhance and manage employee benefit programs if you have employees. You know, you want to make sure you're giving them something to add value. Focus on retaining key employees. And if you establish a business, it's important to keep the employees that are helping you grow. How many people are here are in the business or have their own business? Did you have employees? Okay, so it's important to keep them happy. Otherwise, they're just going to look for another position.
So for employees, you can hire kids.
You can hire anybody you want. You know, but just make sure you're doing the payroll taxes on them and paying them accordingly. You know, it's important to not fall behind on payroll taxes. I mean, I have recently a situation where it is just a single member LLC and he was filing all the payroll tax returns, but he needed money. So what didn't he do? He didn't pay his payroll taxes. So we're up to $150,000 of taxes and penalties and interest. Not if you're scheduled, depends what kind of business you are. Schedule C, if you pay your own children, so if you're a sole proprietor, you don't have to withhold the Social Security and Medicare. Same thing with the spouse. Okay? But once you choose entity types, then you have to. A partnership, S-Corp, a regular corporation. It's also important to know what your business is worth. And even if it's a, something like your, you know that it's a percentage or three times EBITDA, earnings before income tax, depreciation, and amortization, or maybe it's revenue. Maybe you can sell your business for two times revenue. You should know what your business is worth at any point in time, because you don't know when you might be part of something bigger. I mean, you have these stories about people who just started a small business and ended up making millions and millions on what they started. And we want to make sure that, you know, we know what our business is worth. And it's always important that if you do have employees, that you do develop a buy-sell. You know, where what at some point can they buy into the business? Or if something catastrophic happened to one of the key owners, it's important to say what is the parameters for someone to buy in. So a buy-sell, no matter what kind of business you are, and you have key people that you're working with, it's always good. So even if, like I know in an accounting firm, there are sole practitioners, okay? So I was asking one of my friends who is a sole practitioner, I says, what are you gonna do if something happened to you? Cindy, I never thought about it. You know, and I says, well, you should have a plan. So I would think that sole practitioners could hook up with larger accounting firms that can step in if there's, you know, a disability issue, a stroke. I mean, things happen to people that we can't always predict. And everybody should be aware that there are, we should position ourselves to make sure we're. Good questions. A business valuation is usually done by a valuation expert. Okay,
there. Everybody in our industry
then? No, there's usually, like CPAs have valuation experts. They get their certified valuation credentials. So there are people that can do that. There's also people that are not CPAs, but they do valuations. So the thing is to make sure they have credentials. How much does a typical one cost? It depends. If it's a really growing business, I've seen people pay between $2,500 to $15,000. Okay, sometimes you can go online and find, just in case you just want to know how much your business is worth, sometimes you can just Google valuations and see what you come up with. You know, they might have something where you can average the 5 years of last year's, you know, and they normally some of these valuations come back, the lower years are valued less than the most current years, because obviously you're growing your business, so there's a more weighted value on the most current periods, and they'll use your tax return numbers. So there is ways to do it if you just want to get an idea of how much it's worth.
But, you know, as a small business owner, you know, you want to pay the least amount of taxes.
Right.
You get as much deduction as you can. But then you want to sell the business, you want to show all the profit.
Right.
So I'm just like, you know, what do? You know, you want to hide the profits, then you rent the business.
Okay, yes. Well, it is important to minimize profits, you know, and lower your taxes. That's good planning. Okay, but what happens is when you do a valuation, anything that's a benefit to the owner, compensation, rent that you might have paid yourself, some of the fringe benefits, depending upon what it is, health insurance, are usually added back in the calculation. So your profit is higher, okay? And you're seeing a truer picture of the business, because a new owner may not want to take out as much as you did, or they may want to do something different, or merge it with another company that already has all the overhead. So they just want to get a true picture of it.
How about the salaries to the owner? Will that be added back?
Yes, yes, yes.
So,
Some industries, yes. You know, I know like a service business. Right. Now, manufacturing business sometimes is different. Okay, but usually services businesses are times revenue. times revenue, whatever the percentage is. It could be two times. There, right, right. And there's even intangible calculations. So the one that I used to use in the olden days, you know, back in the 70s and 80s, there were like five methods or three methods, and then we took an average of the three. And they incorporated net worth. So it just depends on what kind of calculation you want to do. And sometimes a buy-sell will spell it out. You know, we are going to take the income based upon generally accepted accounting principles. Okay, so they will spell out the way the calculation is being made. Okay, any other questions on valuations? Yes?
No, I'm going back to our employee benefit program.
Yes.
So, you know, those are usually quite expensive, and as you say, enhance and manage. So
right.
How do you navigate, how does a small business navigate that, considering that most of the employee benefit programs are services?
They're not really that expensive, depending upon the type of program you go to. Sometimes you will have a payroll company like Paychex, ADP, Paycor. They will have a 401k that's part of your payroll, and they'll just charge you per employee. And they'll do all the filings and all of whatever else needs to be done. So those kind of things aren't that expensive. When you get into a defined benefit plan, which is where people who make a lot of money want to put away as much as they can for retirement. So they're saying, I want a benefit of X dollars when I'm 65. How much do I have to fund it for? Well, then you need to pay an actuary. And that's when the cost of the program or the plan gets more expensive. So a defined benefit plan is really good if you're making a lot of money and you don't have, and you're one of the older people in the company. It's a benefit for you. But if you're one of the younger companies and you want a defined benefit plan, it's not going to benefit you. So there are different benefit plans, and when somebody has to determine a benefit in the future, that's when it gets to be costly. So pension plans pretty much have gone away. I mean, I don't know very many companies that have pension plans anymore because of the cost factor. And even unions now, they found that they're underfunded. So they're charging employers to get out of that situation. Any other questions on that? Okay. Okay, the goals and planning. So when we decline and transition, we want to ensure that we have the proper succession plan in place. Do we have the key person to carry on the business? Or is it really a business you just want to fold up? It depends what kind of plan you want to have in place. Keep employee morale high during any transition. You know, you want to make sure that you're reassuring them that the succession is going to be seamless. You just don't want someone to start abandoning ship. Because, I mean, I've been through a merger before, and it was pretty seamless, but obviously it wasn't like the other company. So, you know, you're going to have issues, and you just have to work them out. You know, do you want to have a sale? Do you want to merge in with another company? Maybe for exchange of stock? What about keeping it in the family? You know, and then you have different plans. Do we want to keep it in the family and gift it? Do we want to perhaps take a valuation discount on what we're gifting away or selling? Okay, so those are things that you have to consider when you're going to transition and start the business. Declining, you're trying to exit, and you're going to try to transition. And explore ways to minimize your income, estate, and gift taxes when you do transition. Yes? The debt? Death? Well, it depends. Now, if you don't have a buy-sell in place, okay, it goes into the estate, and it's usually left to the spouse or the executor. You know, so we do have companies that, you know, you have to read the will to see where everything goes, and that's what you don't want to do, because half the time, if you have more than one owner, you know, there's a lot of times the owners can't deal with the spouses, and you really don't want to deal with that. Okay.
The order now.
Okay.
Does it have any sale value?
It could.
Based upon
the revenue, and if you can maintain the clientele. If you can't maintain the clientele, then the value won't be there. And that's why it's always good, and I try to tell sole practitioners even in a tax practice, you know, develop the relationship. You may not need it now, but you may need it someday. So you just want to make sure that that's happening. Even in a small business, whether it's just a technology business, you want to make sure that there's a transition in place. And even disaster, if something would happen to the computers, you want to make sure there's a plan, because it could cost your business and the value. Yes? Yes. Mm-hmm. What kind of return was it? A 1065, 1120S? Okay, so it's a 1065? Okay. A filing. No, and if you're willing to file, obviously it must be somebody with multiple owners. Is there more than one owner? Husband and you? Okay, so there's two people in this partnership. What you could do is perhaps have him gift your interest to you. Okay, then it becomes a single member LLC or a single, if it's an LLC, I shouldn't say that. Is it, if it's a partnership, then it's something different. But if it's, if it's a limited liability company, which are pretty easy to set up in Ohio, you may want to just gift the interest to each other, and that becomes a Schedule C. Okay, and if there's nothing to report, you don't have to file. That might save you the filing of the 1065. So consider that, and gifts between spouses are not reportable. Right. You can. Those are the joint ones, and you can do that.
It's not a part, well, it's still a single.
It's a qualified joint venture, I think, is what they call them. QJV.
But
they didn't set it up like that, and they didn't make that election. You probably, when you did it originally, made an election to do that. I don't think they can go back, so they've been filing returns. But that's a good suggestion. There are joint ownership, especially for real estate, when it's a rental property. And why file a 1065? It's just the husband and wife. So you can't enter into an agreement that you're going to put it on as a Schedule E disregarded entity on your return. So you can do that. But right now, since you've been filing 1065s, I would gift my interest to my husband or vice versa. Then you don't have to tell the state you're liquidating it, because it might come into, you know, you can use it for a different purpose even. Right. Right. Now you may have to write a letter to the entity division of the IRS saying, you know, we transfer the interest, so it now is a disregarded entity. You know, so they don't look for the return anymore. So you can file a final return and be done. And just attach a note to the final return that it was gifted over. And I would actually have documents saying I gifted my membership interest to my husband, you know. Any other questions?
But if she wants to reconstitute it at some point in the future, it's no longer
going to
have
the protections of an LLC. It is still an LLC, even though it's a disregarded entity.
Even though you go Schedule C.
Yes, it's still an LLC, it's just a disregarded entity. Now there's some people don't like putting it as part of their tax return, and part of the reason might be that you're getting financing and the bank wants to see the tax return, and then they're going to want to see the whole return. They don't usually like you pulling out a Schedule C from your return. So that's why some people choose to file as an entity and will add a spouse. Some people will also make the spouse a 51% owner so they can go out and get, you know, minority, you know, breaks. Okay, so there's different reasons why you would do that. Any other questions about estate gift and...
You are an encyclopedia.
I'm not an encyclopedia, but I've been doing this for 40 plus years. So,
yes. What is the limit for the gift? If you want to give a gift to your recipient and you are receiving...
14,000.
14,000, and if it's overseas, it's still 14,000.
Not an encyclopedia. Foreign, I think you can still give 14,000, but if you leave me your name and email, I will let you know for sure.
Okay.
Now remember, a husband can join in with a wife, and you can give 28,000 to your mother-in-law.
Okay.
And she can give some to us. So remember, you can give 14,000 per donee.
Okay,
so the only thing I want to caution on is if a husband and wife join in on gifts, make sure it's coming from a joint account, because otherwise they can't.
If it's from joint account, is it still 28 or is it 14?
No, it's still 14 and 14, but a total of 28.
Okay, from the same account.
Yes.
We can give 28 to each of them.
Right, because you're going to get 14 because you're so nice, and she's going to get 14 because she's so nice.
Four.
Exactly.
That's a
lot of money. And then if you want to be on his list, just give him your name before you leave. So, any other questions on that?
So gift tax is what saves?
No. People think that gifting is a big deal. Do I get a deduction for it? Do I have to pay taxes on it? No, gifting is a free thing that you're giving to someone because you like them or because you feel that, you know, it's so gifting involves giving it to individuals. Now, if you write a check to a university or a medical establishment because you want to help someone out, that's not part of your gifting. Okay, that doesn't include the 14,000 or your annual or your gross limitation. Okay, so if you're ever going to do something for a grandchild or a relative of any kind and you're going to pay their tuition, always write the check directly to the university. No, there is no limit on that. It's not considered a gift. Am I under?
Is there a cap to how much I can give total? I give you 14, I defer 14.
No, but you're going to see.
Can you do it at 95% of
the
total?
Yeah.
No, you have to file a gift tax return.
When what becomes red flag?
$5.49 million. once you exceed the $14,000 per individual for the year, you have to file a gift tax return. So when you file that gift return, say you gave $50,000 to your niece. Okay, you were allowed to give her 14, so we're over by 36.
No, I understand that, but if I disperse it amongst others.
Then you're fine. As long as you kept it under 14,000, you can give to each.
Up to?
Doesn't matter.
Under what's realistic red flag?
They don't know. They don't know because you don't have to report it. You don't have to report it. You can give $14,000 to any individual as long as you've documented the gift. There is no red flag because they're not reportable.
To a stranger as well?
To a stranger, if you want to give something to a stranger.
You can dilute everything.
Pardon me?
You can dilute everything.
You can dilute everything. If you're doing it for a gifting purposes, yes. The person receiving the gift doesn't.
You trust everybody.
I mean, I wouldn't gift everything away for planning purposes because I may need it. No, but if you did give $100,000 to some person, you do have to file a gift tax return, and that reduces your 5.49 exclusion.
So the receiver doesn't have to report it as an income, right?
The what? The receiver does not report it as income.
The gift is welcome.
The gift is welcome. Right. Now, I mean, you don't get a deduction for it. You've already, yes.
So do we have to keep them a letter that they said gift from this person? No.
No.
Bank? I was gifted this very early, a very young man, and the gift was to go into the down payment for us. The bank wanted to know where that $20,000 came from.
Okay, hopefully it came from a joint account and it was from a mom and dad. But that was over the limit. So he did have to file a gift tax return, too. Yeah, I mean.
I think now, so I just came up with a joke with this, and I think now they're asking very little
As long as you're not receiving cash, I don't see why it's any of their business. As long as it's not a cash transaction.
I have this money here where it comes from.
They want to make sure it's not another loan or something.
Well, that's, normally you're signing off that it's not a loan, though. So, you know, it's yours. And even if it was a loan between families, then it would probably be subordinated to the bank. No, it has to be given free and clear. Yeah.
Yeah, there's no stipulation. The bank wanted to know what it means. Because it just appeared.
So it's just a verbal agreement.
Well, not between the father and the mother.
You know, and sometimes that I do some financial planning seminars, and parents are actually helping kids, you know, with houses, down payments. Could it be an outright gift? Yes. Could it also be a mortgage or, you know, a loan between them to make them responsible? You know, the interest rate on a long-term loan right now is like under 3%. And what are you getting in the bank in your checking? 0.9? You know, so why not reach out? Do a bona fide note with an interest rate of 3% stipulated, and they're saving, you're saving, or you're actually making money because your bank account is not bearing that much interest. So, you know, there are benefits with family planning too. Oh, I agree, but there might have been something that in the stipulation of the mortgage, I mean, when he signed the papers, I have no idea. Where'd you get the money?
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah. My parents gave me $10,000.
Yeah. Why did it disappear?
Yeah. Where did this come from? It was just put in the next month.
Well, did you give them a financial statement that showed that there wasn't any savings? Or you knew how much savings
no,
you...
No, I didn't get anything all at once.
And if they look at a tax return and they see you have no interest income, so they assume you have nothing in the bank, so they could be saying, where did this come from? You know,
yeah,
so... But they shouldn't care, but like, I didn't.
What they care is fine, but there is something called money laundering. You sell a kilo of drugs, you get a lot of money.
You want to go to the bank with them, right?
A dollar, one time. Green bill doesn't tell whether it's drug money or not. So they are being careful.
But if you have too much cash, like over $5,000 in cash, they ask.
It's 10,000, but they do ask. They do ask. They have to report you too. They have to report you to the government under the Patriot Act. They really do want to know. Yeah, cash. I mean, that was like the used car salesman too. I mean, they sell cars for cash when they make a deposit. If it's over 10,000, they ask. So, okay. Any other questions on that? Okay, what is business planning then? Like that key word we talked about earlier. It involves making decisions about the future of your business. It considers long-term and short-term goals. The typical plan covers 5 years and creates annual budgets. And I can't stress enough, planning should not be year by year by year. And you're gonna see that when even I talk about financial planning and retirement, 5 years. Look at it before 5 years before you retire. That is key. Planning is important. Okay, it helps improve the business control. It helps to allocate resources effectively. And it helps to communicate to your potential to lenders and customers. So you really want to make sure that you have a 5-year. It shows that you know what you're doing. Okay, so annual business plans to consider, you should have a personal plan. You should have a strategic plan. You should have an annual operating plan and your forecast. Now, it sounds like a lot of work, okay? And it could be something as simple on the back of a napkin, as long as you documented it. Okay, I'm not gonna say that it has to be in technology on Excel spreadsheets. I mean, even though that's ideal, okay? But if you have something, in fact, when I was going through this Hobby Loss audit, the guy just had a lot of research about cows. He was so interested in cows, he gave me every document he ever had. He never wrote anything down. but he had all this literature. And I took that to IRS, and I said, look, he looked at this. He wanted to become a specialist in this. And they were cows that were better grades of beef. You know, and the Amish were actually helping him develop these kind of breeds of cows. And it did take a long time, like you said, when writing a book. So we were able to document that he had all this literature, he had all this research, and his documentations with the Amish community. So we were able to document something that gave him 2 out of the 9 factors. So it wasn't really a written plan, but I was able to communicate to the IRS that he, because he really was a think tank man. I mean, he was thinking of so many different ideas. You could tell on his tax return that he had new businesses coming up all the time, but he just never followed through all the time. But he did have a good sense of making things happen. Okay, so moving on to the personal plan, it doesn't need to be a formal document, like I said. The thought process to help identify why are you in business? What are your goals and expectations of being in business? You need to review your cash requirements of the business. How much cash flow will be required for the business? How much will you need to withdraw from the business? I mean, sometimes you're doing it along with another job, so you don't need as much as somebody that was using it for full time. And you see a lot of times that the husband will be working, the wife now became a mom and wants to start their business, you know, whether it's photography or whatever. But you want to make sure that you have a plan. And how much are you going to contribute to the family household income? So you want to make sure you're getting there. You need to analyze your personal spending, income, and savings reserves. That goes for any kind of thing, financial decisions we're making. We should always analyze what we have. So the strategic plan, it maps out where business should be in the future, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years. It develops specific strategies to reach long-term goals, and the annual budgets must conform to those goals. It starts with a mission statement, and then analyze the internal structure of the business and the external business environment. It identifies the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats, a SWOT analysis. You know, what are your strengths and your personal strengths for the business? What kind of weaknesses do you need to supplement? Do you have to hire somebody? Or can you just do it with technology? What opportunities exist out there? And who are my threats? Who are the companies that are going to threaten my expansion? And you take the business from the current position to the optimal position. The annual operating plan is the budget. You detailed financial projections to show why business is ahead or behind the planned performance. It includes revenue sales, cost of sales, operating expenses, and the general and administrative expenses. Forecasts are usually quick and informal revisions to the original plan, you know, because things do change during the year. So you might have to go through some revisions to your forecast or your budgets. Accounting for unforeseen circumstances. Hurricanes, depending upon where you're located. So there are things that could happen that you want to make sure you're able to document. Okay, so we're going to go from business planning now to personal financial planning. Yes?
The forecast, you also do forecasting.
Of the what?
Of demand. How is your market share?
Right, and who's demanding your product? Right.
And the,
exactly, because you might, I mean, a biggest thing now is with the tax professionals is the phishing, tax identity theft. So this year, last year they were targeting the medical professionals, okay, because some of the most important critical information are in healthcare records. So a lot of the healthcare professionals, I mean, wasn't Aetna targeted? If anybody got Aetna, they can log in for your free ID theft for 2 years. Or a year, you know, but if those people that are stealing our identity, they're going to wait till the 2 years, now they're going to go back. So it's kind of like, you know, what's the purpose of this protection? So this year, we're being bombarded with information saying, they're targeting tax professionals. You have a wealth of knowledge out there. You know, we're going to just try to target. So they're trying to get us to respond to these different phishing or scams. Yeah, I mean, we're getting a lot of Dropbox stuff.
Violence?
No. From people phishing to come into our system. So they're targeting us now as CPA professionals. And that's why tax identity theft is really critical, and we should always stay on guard. Never, ever, ever, ever respond to an email from IRS or the state of Ohio, for the most part. State of Ohio might be contact you by email, but IRS will never, ever, ever, ever contact you by email or by phone. So if someone calls you up and says, I'm from the IRS and you owe back taxes, hang up. The first thing they're going to do is send you a letter. Now, if it comes out that they've been investigating you, they may knock on your door. Okay? But if you're under criminal investigation. Okay? But you would know that, you know? So you want to make sure that you're not responding anything via email or phone to the IRS. Don't ever. Okay, so that's one thing. So, you know, we have to protect ourselves. And this year, I mean, tax preparers have a wealth of knowledge. This year we have to get driver's license numbers, issue date, and expiration date. Because Ohio will not let you e-file without that information. So, you know, you just want to be careful and on guard. Okay, so we're going to move from business planning to personal financial planning. How much time is there left? I do have time? Okay. Just like businesses, our needs change during different stages of our lives. We're faced with financial decisions that have lasting effects on our financial future. And I think that I'm old enough to know that I've been through every stage of life. I have been sandwich generation, you know, I took care of my kids, moved on to take care of my parents. So I think I've had experienced a lot. And I see the impact it has, both good and bad. So what we want to make sure that we're doing is making sure we can plan for that. And there is something called generational financial planning. And I started that probably back in my younger days. My parents used to always go to Florida during the winter. And they said, Cindy, this is all yours. You're an accountant. You can handle this, right? My dad, you know, he pay my credit cards, pay my electric bill, pay my gas bill. I says, well, wait a minute, Dad. You know you can register and pay it through the bank and let them take it out every month? So, you know, those are things that we can help out with. And I try to get my kids to be aware of that, too. You know, Grandma needs this. Can you help her with that? Or Grandpa needs this. Can you help her with that? And I think generations can help each other. And that's what we have to worry about. So in the Family Balancing Act, we need to focus on goals. First, our own goals. What are our own goals? If you can't satisfy your own goals, you're not going to satisfy anybody else's. So you want to account for longevity. Normally, you look at your family's history. How long did Mom and Dad live? Barring any unusual situations in life, that's a pretty good indicator of how long you're going to live. Although the recent mortality tables, I hate to say this, dropped mortality by a half a year. So they're saying we're going to live a half a year less than what it's always been. Just to let you, and I think part of it might be stress. I mean, I don't know if you picked up some of the obituaries lately, how many times you see 60-year-olds in there? Well, they did, right, you're right. So it's like 84 and a half now for women versus what it was, or men, and then 87 and a half for, so I don't know what the exact numbers are, but they decreased it by a half a year. And I think it's stress, I think a lot of it is environment. You know, whether, will it shoot back up? I'm not so sure. All I know is that being raised in the 50s and 60s, and then having a family in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, there's a lot of stress. You try to do it all, you know? And I don't know if the education made us want to do more, but we have to realize that that could be a factor. And we have to document the details of our financial plan and begin having honest conversations, whether it's with your own parents or with your kids. Have conversations with them earlier rather than later. You know, we should all encourage people to take ownership of their personal finances. Become self-reliant. Use technology, spreadsheets. I have a son, my sons are actually If I ask them how much they spent for utilities in 2015, they'll pull up their spreadsheet and tell me what they paid. You know, they're just technology like that. The one thing about that generation, which is the 30s-year-olds, they're self, I mean, they really want to do everything themselves. The do-it-yourself generation, you know. I can fix my car because I can see the YouTube. You know, I can do this because I'm going to do the YouTube. I mean, I remember doing this beef once, and I didn't know how to do it. My son goes, well, look up it on YouTube. Okay, so we did that. So, you know, they're do-it-yourselfers. The only thing about being a do-it-yourselfers is that sometimes you don't really have the knowledge or the expertise. So I encourage them. I mean, I love people taking control of their finances and understanding what's happening. But if they're going to enter their tax return in TurboTax, great program, that's great. But every 2 years, let a professional look at it. Because if you do that, if there's an error that you might have overlooked or you didn't understand about the small business deduction in Ohio or whatever, you can go back and file an amended return within the statute. Okay? Not every year. Have fun. Do it yourself. Enjoy the questions that the Turbo asks you. But every 2 years, have somebody look at it. Well, for Ohio, it's 4. Or federal, it's 3. So any return that we file this year that's due 17, so the 16 return, you have until the 2020, April 2020 to file it, if you filed on time. If you filed an extension, there's the extended period. They want you to have profit at least 1 out of 3 out of 5 years. 3 out of 5 years. They want you to make sure. So, but then again, I told you that there's writers, you know, you just want to make sure that you have a profit out of one of those years, you know, so. That's fine. Well, you should, but I mean, then you try to say, you know, it depends how much you really, if you're fair and honest, you don't have to worry about it. And if it truly is a business and you have a business plan, there are things that happen that we can't control. So don't be afraid as long as you have everything documented. Now, if you're just throwing receipts here and putting numbers on returns, then I have to say maybe be concerned about that. But if you really have a business plan, you really talk to people and you know where to go, you know, you've been doing all your proper steps, then I wouldn't worry about it. If there's a loss, there's a loss. Like I told you, this guy had losses for like 10 to 15 years, and they gave him 2 9s out of it because he did meet all 9 criteria. You only meant 2. So, and I wouldn't be afraid of documenting losses if you have them. Okay. Tapping community resources is good. I mean, I'm an ARC member. I've been an ARC member since I was age 50. It has some really good things out there. Even their magazines are good. So even senior communities, they actually have a lot of things out there too for us. So I really would think that you could tap into community resources. Okay, in the financial planning process, you have to gather data. And like any other thing, you have to prepare a plan. And then you want to present the plan to family, your spouse, you want to make sure you have a plan in place. And then looking how to implement that plan. How am I going to get to that vacation home I want in Myrtle Beach? How am I going to get there? And then you want to monitor and maintain that plan. And the one thing I want to stress is that financial planning begins with our first paycheck. Okay, we should pay ourselves first. You pay yourself first. And that doesn't mean that you take $20 out of it or whatever. Take advantage of employer plans. You know, 401ks. Just make sure you're paying yourself first. If you're not going to put it in a retirement account, put it into a health savings account if that's eligible for you. If it's not a health savings account, put it into a savings account. Just remember to pay yourself first. So there are also key areas of financial planning personally. You have your cash flow management, risk management. Do you have proper insurance? If you own a business, do you have the proper umbrella policy perhaps? Do you have a disability policy? If this is your sole business, this is your sole life, do you have a disability policy? You want to make sure you're completely covered. Investment planning, some people, once again, like to be do-it-yourselfers. I personally use a broker. I am a financial planner too, but I don't like dealing with investments. You know, I'd rather have somebody that has the expertise do that for me. Tax planning strategies. Every year, we should always do our tax planning once we file our tax return for that year. Okay, so in April, when we file our tax return, our 17 planning should already begin. What should I look at? How can I do something to plan? Okay, you know, I just filed my tax return. We have two kids in college, and our joint return shows a little bit too much more income. You know, I can't get any of those nice American Opportunity tax credits or whatever else is out there. What can I do? Well, you didn't put anything in your 401k. Okay, I'll put something in my 401k. It gets me down below the limit. Now I got my education credits. So there are things that we can do. If you're over 65 and you're on Medicare, we have to realize now it's mean tested. So they base it upon your adjusted gross income from 2 years ago. So in 17, they looked at your 2015 tax return and they said, oh, you made over the limit. You know, as a single person, it's 89,000. So if your AGI is over 89,000, they're gonna charge you more for Medicare. Okay, so how can you get your adjusted gross income down? These are all planning techniques. And there are opportunities out there. You just have to look through for them. Yes?
For college, if you have kids in college and you are paying out of your pocket after the scholarship and all that, do we get any tax deduction from the college fees or no?
Depending upon your adjusted gross income, okay, you could get a tuition and fees deduction.
We could.
Or the American Opportunity Credit. Or the Lifetime Learning Credit. So there's a few opportunities out there, depending upon your American Opportunity Credit. Those are for the first 4 years of college, for tuition only. Lifetime Learning Credit is for all years of schooling. Okay, an American Opportunity Credit is per child. Lifetime Learning is per return. Okay, and the tuition and fees is per return. Okay.
And so what can you, so on top of that, what can you charge for your own budget? And you're deducting for
no. He's really has some.
No, but isn't there a self-learning deduction?
No. Self-learning where you're devoting hours to reading and only if you pay outside. If you pay outside, it's yes.
Continued
education.
Yeah.
Right, but you not if you're just reading on your own. You say, I'm worth $50 an hour, so I can take
no,
this.
I get that. I get that.
Okay, yeah, continuing education, if you're an employee,
yeah,
it'll go on a 2106. Okay, if it's really on a business and you're really, there is no limit. Pardon me? You could have training. I mean, there could be. Yeah, you could technically write it off on your Schedule C or on your business return. Retirement planning and estate planning. And our goals throughout life will determine our financial planning needs. So these are the key advisors when you want to pick for financial planning success. You want to have an accountant, tax advisor, an attorney.
So many people.
So many people, but they work as a team. So you may not need all of them. The only thing when I do financial plans is that I see that, you know, the insurance advisor or the investment advisor really doesn't know what the tax person found out. So every year, I know I try to touch base with my investment advisors for my clients, saying, oh, we have this loss carry forward, so try to use it next year. You know, so it's communication and planning. Right. If it's for stock, for business, yeah, you can keep carrying those over.
Yeah, that's why
15 years. Stock, you're limited to $3,000 of loss, and those go until you die. If you don't utilize your losses, I mean, I have clients who have like $300,000-$400,000 of losses,
yeah,
and they're taking $3,000 a year, but they die when you die. Yes. That's proper tax planning. So if you know that you have losses to carry over, you call your investment advisor up and say, hey, Am I sitting on any unrealized gains? Let's sell it. And then buy it back if you want to within, you know, 30 days or whatever, to avoid the wash sale rules. Okay, and then we're going to go into some fact-finding documents. So keys to financial planning success, mirror business planning. You know, you want to make sure you have a plan documented. You want to make sure that you reviewed it. And it's, I tell couples all the time, because half the time husbands and wife sometimes keep things separated. I see now that my 70-year-old male clients want their wives to come in to see me only because they're afraid if something happens to them, at least they'll have a contact. And some of these wives they haven't seen. So they're trying, you know, and I don't know if it was the 70 to 80-year-olds or whatever, but and my sister's a prime example too. She knew nothing about her finances when she's retired. Her husband did everything. You know, so right now, she's getting, you know, finances for dummy books, and she's reading them, and she's trying to become more attuned to what she has.
She doesn't call you?
She does. I was just over there on Sunday to discuss some things. Actually, my family pretty much, except for my elder sister, they pretty much keep their things separately. They're pretty private about what they have. So, that's probably right. So, okay, so financial and tax planning do go hand in hand, especially in a multi-generational setting. You know, when you're a family, you focus on retirement, education, investing, income protection, and asset protection. If you own a business, you're focusing on maximizing the value of that business, succession planning, buy-sell planning, and retaining key employees. And when you put both together and you have a successful business and you have enough to live on, you go into legacy planning. What am I going to do with this money I have left over? So in addition to estate planning, you know, business owners might have some kind of philanthropy intentions. For the most part, unless Trump changes things or whatever, if you're in Ohio and you have less than a $5.49 million estate per person, so a husband and wife can have $10.98 million, you'll probably never ever pay taxes for an estate. Because Ohio is an estate tax-free state. Okay? And for federal, you know, there's no big deal. The only thing Trump is proposing is that, and I don't know how we're going to do this, but he's saying that, okay, we're not going to have any more estate tax at all, but everybody has to, you don't get the step up in basis anymore at death. You're paying, you're going to get the cost basis. So how many times do I know what my mom and dad paid for something? You know, so that's why I think they're going to work some of those things out. Okay, because I can't believe that. I mean, everybody in the past said, you know, if you had the AT&T stock and they split up into all those baby bells, just hold on to them until you die, because you get a step up in basis. Don't worry about figuring out the basis. So, you know, it's one of those things that you try to tell people, if you don't know the basis now, when you die, whoever inherits it will get a step up. Whatever, the step is the date of death value. So if you hold IBM stock and you bought it for 50 cents a share, but when you die, it's worth $300 a share. Whoever inherits that stock, when you die, it's $300. Okay?
And so otherwise, you can transfer at 57 cents?
You can transfer, like, what are you going to do, gift it? Or what are you gonna, no, Trump is saying that.
Yeah.
Trump is saying that, okay, we're not going to have a step up anymore, but you're going to have to
cost basis. Wow.
So, but there's no estate tax. So, but eventually you're going to pay the capital gains on it. So.
Yeah, that's okay. It's better than paying taxes on the capital gains.
Right. So that's why I think that that's going to be all thought through, just like the Affordable Care Act. You know, they're putting it on hold, but there's been some uproar because it has benefited some people. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens between 18 and 19. And once again, you have slides in there talking about how to teach from financial literacy from 5 to 8 year olds. And I know that.
Below five?
No, it's. But you know, you can teach kids at a young age the importance of saving. You know, whether it's comparing cereal products, do you really need that General Mills, well, whatever they make, Cheerios, or can you use the food club? Is there a difference? Buy both of them, see if there's a difference. Okay, so I think that overall, you know, we can teach kids. I know my father did a great job with my sons. I was a single parent, and he taught my kids that, you know, when you recycle cans, you get money. So they would go around and, you know, recycle cans, and when they came back with $8, they were excited. So they knew that was a job, you know, and they were young.
So my daughter, you know, and we say it like that, you know, they realize, but the other day, you know, we were at the store, and, you know, we're trying, she was trying to buy something, and I didn't have any cash. And she looked at her and said, Dad, don't you have a credit card? and she ate, you know, and I was really blown away because I didn't really realize that they know that much.
Oh, know, yeah.
At that age. So, you know, we had to have all this long discussion about, you know, using credit cards and how you borrow money and you have to pay back.
And I agree with you.
So, yeah, they do.
No, they do.
Yeah, but then college students don't know.
Well, that's where, as college students, I don't mind them having credit cards. But remember, you can set the limit on those credit cards. You know, I know they want to keep raising it to 2,500, 5,000, 10,000. But you can say, I don't want it higher than 500. Because that's how much I can actually stand to lose if there's a situation. You know, so you really want to make sure you're watching that. When my kids went off to college, I gave them a credit card with their name on it, but I was in it. So I got the statements and I saw what they were buying. You know, so I was paying for it too, but at least I saw it. And they had the responsibility for it. So, you know, there's different things that we should do. And too often, parents and grandparents bail kids out. You know, they bail them out because, you know, we don't want to see them get hurt. Okay, I don't know if that's a wise answer. I'd sooner probably draw up a note if I was a grandparent and I wanted to pay off a credit card because it went up to $1,500 for my grandson or my, I would probably say, I'll give you the $1,500, but this is a 3% interest rate for now. You're going to pay me with interest. Okay, I would never probably just help them out. You just drop a real note, get it notarized, the bank's notarized. I would, you know, and then call it if it's not, you know. Just teaching them a lesson, teaching, I mean, it's easy to, I mean, my, you know, we've done that all the time as parents, you know, we, you know, kids want something, we just say, okay. But we don't have consequences when something doesn't go right. Yes?
She broke her tablet when she was 8, 9. And I wouldn't buy her a new one.
And so my papa thought he was buying me one, but I had to pay him back because my mom was gutted.
Well, that was probably good a learning experience for you, because now you're probably more careful with the tablet.
Paid off.
But speaking about privacy and financial, there was a good tip I heard, and I should probably say this, and she mentioned the tablet. They said because of security and how everybody pays their bills online now and everything else, someone gave this advice that if you buy an iPad, they're so cheap, so inexpensive, and use it just for those financial bills, you're going to be more secure, okay, because you're not doing anything else with it. So that's a good suggestion. I thought it was a good suggestion. I haven't done it yet, but, okay, and we talked about the 20 to 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds that are do-it-yourselfers, and the one thing to realize is that you can never save too much. You can always spend too much, but you can never save too much. Okay, aging impacts our financial decision-making. And elder financial abuse is on the rise. Grandparents are getting called saying, Johnny's in Tijuana and he's in jail, you know, he needs $1,000. You know, grandparents fall for things because they can't make the decision. And as you get older, you know, you don't have the ability to react and analyze the situation. So, warning signs of financial decline, you know, slowness in completing financial tasks. I mean, I don't suggest taking things away if they still want to write their own checks, but you have to be careful. You know, missing key details in financial documents, just problems with everyday math like adding, decreased understanding with financial concepts. And I saw that in my dad. My dad kept saying, well, now I don't understand it. Can you just repeat that one more time? You know, he had a hard time. He was a business owner. So at some point he knew, you know, yeah, he was 93. He just needed me to explain it. Troubles identifying risk and investment opportunities. Pardon me? Obligated? Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if there is an obligation factor here. And I think I did it because I saw my parents took care of my grandparents. And I think it's just a thing that you develop. I don't think there's a right or wrong answer. You know, some parents don't want to be taken care of. You know, my dad would refuse to move in with me. So I said, okay, I'm going to move in with you. It just makes my life easier. You know, so I sold my house and moved in with him. You know, it was just easier. We were able to do everything we needed to do. Luckily, my younger sister took care of him during the day when he needed assistance. And I was able to continue to work. Sometimes families just pull together. I mean, I feel sorry for families that have only one child because that's really difficult. So, okay, we make the best financial decisions when we understand the underlying financial concepts, possess the competencies to evaluate the risks and rewards of the options, and have confidence to choose the right decision. We can also prepare younger generations to assist their elders, which will have the added benefit to help them make better financial decisions for themselves. A typical plan involves investing in a diversified portfolio, spending conservatively, and making adjustments in the future as necessary. Investment strategies, these are just some key guidelines. Obviously, when we're younger, we can, in the 20s, you're really saving for something in the future. Okay, so you really want to be more liquid than investing. As you move to the 30s, you're trying to develop growth so you can actually be a little bit more riskier. Same thing with the 40s. 50s, we're starting to decrease a little bit, less risk. And obviously when we're in our 60s, like me, we have to start taking a little bit more less risk. Here are some tax strategies and tax tips. We want to maximize our employer retirement plans as early as possible. Health savings arrangements, anybody part of those? Great. Encourage kids to participate, because remember, they don't go to doctors. They should be in an HSA. You know, I'm trying to get my kids to at least go to their annual preventive exams. You know, but they don't use doctors. And if they can save this pre-tax, when they do need it, they'll be able to take it out tax-free and pay for expenses when they don't have the money maybe to have to pay for them. So this is a tax, it's before taxes and it comes out tax-free. It's only eligible for if you have a high deductible health care plan.
I have a question.
Yes.
I have my own business. Mm-hmm. That is going to give them insurance. And then I'm part of that insurance. They don't want health savings because they want low deductible. They don't want high deductible. So because of that, we have a really nice health plan. So I want to do the health saving plan for ourselves. Can that be possible?
You can, as long as you're offering it to both the employees and yourself. Yes.
They don't,
but you have to offer it. You're giving them a choice. Like at our place of employment, we have the choice of being in an HSA or in a really good plan. But what happens then? If I'm in the HSA, I pay nothing. But if I'm in one of those better plans, you're paying $180, $190. A month. So sometimes to encourage or entice employees to be part of an HSA, employers will contribute to it, and that might even reduce your premiums anyways. Because HSAs are beneficial, because the premiums are a lot lower.
So and the money you put in there, does it expire?
Nope. Now I consider that a medical IRA. Okay, well you can't contribute it after you're 65 and on Medicare. Can't contribute to it. But you can take the money out.
Okay, so can we have both plans then?
You can. As long as it's offered to all classes of employees.
Okay.
Yes.
If they choose not to be part of this, then
I would penalize them, though. I mean, it seems like I would say you're going to pay $100 for it if you don't want to be part of the HSA, because those premiums are a lot lower. Yes? Everything but premiums. Yeah, only for prescriptions, copays, you know, so vision, dental. No, I don't think so. My problem, I have one that I'm accumulating, but I know that when I turn 65, I'm not going to have health care coverage through my employer, so I'm going to use that plan to cover for my Medicare Part D, my prescription drugs,
so
vision, dental. Right. No, but what if I need glasses or contacts, or, you know, I'm going in for dental work, I can use that. And I've already put it away tax-free, I'm not paying for it. Now, I can also take it out of there, pay tax on the earnings, and go on a trip. No penalty, as long as I'm over 65.
Okay, so there are other...
You can, but you have to pay tax on the gross. Okay. Well, actually, that tax probably on the whole distribution. Yes. Go ahead. So, no, I think it's on the tax, because you put it away tax-free, and you're not paying it for medical, so it's going to be on the whole thing.
Yeah, but then
it's
what growth?
Yeah, yeah. Hell, HSAs have investment opportunities. Yeah. Yeah, sometimes Vantage, Fidelity, or Vanguard Fidelity. You can, but you're taxed on it if it's not for medical purposes.
Okay.
Because you wouldn't when it went in. Yes?
Did you mention, can you use it to survive and pay for a year by your
Medicare supplement?
Yeah.
No.
Well, you cannot.
No, but you could do it for Medicare Part D.
For Part D?
Yeah, the drug coverage. And your vision, dental care?
So D, you can.
D, you can.
Yeah.
Vision? Dental? Yes.
When
did this start?
2010 or 11,
maybe? 10? So yeah, I mean, I like my plan because I'm going to use it when I turn 65. It's my medical IRA. 529 plan's good. I mean, if you want to help fund an education for someone, if it's an Ohio College Advantage plan, you're allowed to take a $2,000 deduction on your tax return per beneficiary. So if you have three grandchildren or you have three children and you want to put $6,000 away towards their education, you get a $6,000 deduction on your Ohio return, as long as it's an Ohio plan.
I have a question.
Yes.
529. If you have two kids, the 529 plan, and for one kid, that one kid is done, can that plan be used to pay for the second?
You change the beneficiary.
Right.
In fact, a lot of people don't realize, and this happened to a relative of mine, he got a full ride to college. So he didn't need any of the money in the 529 plans. So he was able to take out of the 529 without penalty the amount of the scholarship. Okay? The only thing he had to pay tax on was the growth, the earnings in that plan. But there were no penalties. All they were reimbursing him. So now he has money for a car. When he graduates, he'll have enough money for a car, which is his reward. Because the parents saved it there for that. There are nationwide plans.
Right.
Yes. But if you want the Ohio benefit, you have to go into an Ohio plan. It doesn't have to be used in Ohio colleges. It just has to be an Ohio College Advantage plan. Yeah, you can. You can use it in graduate school, medical school, as long as it's a certified, accredited university.
And how long do you know when the master's 3 years from now?
My sister is saving hers for her grandchildren, who aren't even born yet. So you can keep it as a beneficiary. You can save it, you know. But if you die, then you have to make sure that someone's going to be able to name a beneficiary. Yes.
Age restriction on
You can use it. In fact, I told her the same thing. I said, why don't you go back to school and use it?
Just change the beneficiary.
Just change the beneficiary. Yes?
Can you do that real time? I have a daughter in school,
For this year, next year? Yes. I have somebody in the office that's doing that. He's putting it away this, but he's going to take it out right away. You're just not going to have the growth, but you're going to get the state deduction.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. And you just have to watch to make sure that there's any kind of penalties for taking it out too early. I don't think there would be.
Okay.
You just watch the plan, but it has to be an Ohio College Advantage plan.
Okay, that's after tax.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Right. The year that it's used or the year you set it aside?
The year you set it aside. So if you're doing it for a four-year-old, you get it a year that, you know, I had grandparents that gave like $50,000 away. Because you're only allowed to use it for $2,000 per year, you're allowed to carry it forward. So if you give more, say you want to fund 10, you're allowed to take that $2,000 for 5 years.
For the same beneficiary.
For the same beneficiary.
Okay. You can't do it for more.
Yes. So if you have four kids, you can put $20,000, $5,000 each, take $8,000 this year, and the balance next year. No, because right now he didn't put it in yet.
Right.
So if he's putting it, it has to go.
If he filed already, if he had filed already, could he amend?
No, because he's putting it in 2017.
Or no, I paid, yeah, right.
You're putting the 529 plan in 2017. I keep saying what?
Ohio College
Advantage Plan.
Right. But can be used in any college?
Yes. Yes. It's just that some of these plans have different growth rates. Some don't do as good as others. So a lot of people were staying away from the Ohio College Advantage because the growth rate wasn't really good. But I think they've gotten better, and they've given you more options. Because I think BlackRock is in it now, one of the investment opportunities. Well, I know. You know, that's where, you know, but there are, they do have other investment opportunities now. It may not be BlackRock or whatever.
So other states...
Virginia has one.
Education.
Yeah. American funds.
College anywhere.
Yes. Yes.
So if you want to use the money that you save for your children for your own education, you need to change
beneficiary. Yes. Yeah, I mean you can just keep switching beneficiaries. Because I have a client who wanted to name her granddaughter the beneficiary, but she didn't want to jeopardize any scholarship that she could maybe see, because 529 plans, depending on who owns them, it's get rated different for financial aid. Okay, so grandparents are, if it's a grandparent plan, who's the owner, the grandparent, then financial aid rates it higher, is more of a qualifying asset. But if it's in the parent's name, it's not as high, the, you know, percentage-wise. So I said, well, switch it to the younger beneficiary for her junior year in high school. Okay, see what happens with the scholarships. And then switch it back if she needs it. I mean, you can switch beneficiaries. I think it's only once a year, but it depends upon the plan. Yes?
Last question. I probably may have covered earlier.
No problem.
I paid tuition, in 2016 tuition for my daughter. We had financial aid, so I paid a portion.
It depends what your adjusted gross income is.
Okay.
If it's under 180, I think.
Then I can write it off.
You don't write it off, you get a credit.
I get a credit.
Yeah. And if it's the first 4 years, it's $2,500 pretty much. Yeah, if it's for the first 4 years of college. Yes.
Per year.
Yes.
Over 180.
No. And that's not a lot of money for a person putting kids through school. So.
Right.
And that does not adjust it for inflation. Hybrid long-term care policies. If you're looking at a long-term care, I'm not an advocate of long-term care premiums. If you don't use it, you lose it. These new policies that are out there are hybrid, which means that they can be a life insurance policy or an annuity. And if for some reason you need long-term care, they kick into a long-term care policy. If you don't need it, it stays there and goes to your beneficiaries. So those are kind of like new kids on the block. because people really weren't buying long-term care policies. But it's still an investment that's protected then. Everybody knows that we have to plan for capital gains, and if you're fortunate or unfortunate to be in a higher bracket and have to pay the net investment income tax, there's planning. AMT planning, you know, one out of every three people, taxpayers, pay alternative minimum tax. There is times where you might be able to plan around it. Other times there may not be. If you're planning on retiring within the next 5 years, I suggest you do a multi-year planning. The only reason I'm going to suggest that is that you don't want your income to go up and down. You want it to be as level as possible. So you might be in a lower income, but you might be able to take IRAs out to put it out. You might want to postpone your Social Security collecting until you're 70, okay, which a lot of people do. So you can, okay, I'll take my IRA out. Because remember, I don't know if how many beneficiaries really want to inherit an IRA, because why? They have to pay taxes on it. So spend your IRA down and leave your other assets there. Planning for Medicare premiums, we've already talked about. Social Security planning strategies, they did change the collection. You can't suspend and collect anymore. You can manage the taxation of Social Security benefits. I think that's a crime that we pay tax on our Social Security, because that's a tax on a tax. Like, that's really double taxation. Charitable contributions for RMDs. I think this is really a good idea for people that they go to church every week, and you know, some people I see, they give $4,000 a year to the church, but they do it every week. Rather than do that, give your $4,000 from your IRA directly. Don't give your weekly contributions. You're still giving the same amount to your church, and now you've reduced your adjusted gross income because your RMD was lower. Required minimum distributions from an IRA that you have to take out when you're 70 and a half. Okay, so these are ways to reduce your adjusted gross income if you can. Because remember, mean tested, Medicare premiums are mean tested. So I have clients that, you know, if they take $100,000 of an RMD and they're charitably inclined anyways, give 50 of it away to the charity directly. Your adjusted gross income goes down, you pay less Ohio tax. Plus now everything that's based upon adjusted gross income, like your Medicare premiums or whatever, is now helping you. Charitable contributions, no. As long as you have records, don't worry about it. The worst thing they're going to do is send you a letter and say, send in proof of your charitable contributions. And if you've been honest and you've collected all your receipts and you have the information. No, you can't. That's why I would pay everything by check. I do very little. You should register with a parish or give a check. You know, even at work when we have our jeans day, you're supposed to give $1 on Friday or give a quarterly donation. I write a check. You know, but I give more than $1 a Friday, so I make my charitable contribution through my check. No, I mean, I have clients that give away and they were honest.
No, but 93% charity.
There are guidelines, but I. Exactly. I have a client who he tithes. He makes $150,000, he gives $15,000 to charity. Okay? He has receipts for those. He occasionally might get a letter from IRS saying that, you know, can you just, it says just a correspondence audit, and then I have to Xerox all his receipts and the letters from the charity and send them off, and he's fine because he got them.
So is 10% charity a big flaggy amount?
Is it a flaggy amount? It might generate a letter. As long as you can prove it, it's no big deal. So, longevity annuities, what this allows you to do is take part of your IRA and put it into an annuity that you don't have to really touch until you're 85. It's like up limited to 125,000. Once again, what that does is help you to reduce your RMDs. And because you don't have to take that money and it's not part of your RMDs. Haven't seen much, this is relatively new, I haven't seen much in this area yet. Okay, when people reach 70 and a half, they have to take RMDs, required minimum distributions. Well, you, right now, IRS is giving you the opportunity to take $125,000 of your IRA account, put it into an annuity, a longevity annuity, that you really don't have to touch until you're 85. And so that becomes out of your RMD. And then so once again, you don't have to take out as much, depending on how much people accumulated. I see our generation who has, you know, save, save, save. We put a lot in our retirement accounts. So we'll see how that turns out. I don't know. Yes?
So do you do that in one lump sum for
yes.
a year?
Yeah, you, I mean, you can take it out earlier than 85 if you want.
No, but I mean...
Oh, no, no. When you turn 70 and a half, you can do it at that point. Take 125 of your IRA balance and transfer it to this longevity annuity.
And it's covered.
Well, it's supposed to help you. It would take away from your required minimum because that's not going to be part of your balance. Yeah. Okay, so it's one of those little things out there yet that people, but you have to take it out at 85.
Yeah.
They're hoping that people will realize that there's more money out there now than so they live longer. Okay, this is transitioning closely held. No, just once. Just once. No, you don't. It's part of your IRA balance. Okay. Here's a little bit about transitioning a closely held business. We won't go into that. What we did give you is a part of the key estate planning documents. Okay. I want people to make sure that you have your medical directives. You know, your living will, your durable power of attorney for health care. Keep at least 3 years of tax returns in a secure place. Tax returns are a wealth of knowledge. So if anything would happen to you, they can actually identify what assets you have. Durable power of attorney, make sure you have one of those. You might need a living trust. Now with the way things, you can title everything properly, transfer on death or jointly if you're married. So you can actually do a lot of things without having a living trust. Wills are necessary just for the catch-all. Life insurance policy, reviewing designations of beneficiaries on both retirement accounts and life insurance. So I'm encouraging people to create this financial journal, to leave it as a legacy. There is nothing worse than when someone passes away and you're scrambling to find out what they own. You know, and I don't want to do that to my sons. My parents had no problems because they knew I knew everything. So, you know, you just don't want to make sure that the next generation is available, is able to handle whatever you've left behind.
So is this something that you actually journal?
I do. You know, and that's why we have technology now. You can put things on a spreadsheet. So what we've done was we, on your, did they get a thumb drive? Okay, so if you want copies of documents, we can give you this. It's our financial journal that we've created, and you have to fill in things yourself. A net worth statement, I feel that everyone at every age, starting when they have their first job, should create a net worth statement to see what they're worth. And every year they can see when they do their tax return, hey, I really did save. It gives them a good feeling that they've improved their net worth. The document locator is a resource that, I don't think we have one here. Oh yeah, we do. Okay, so this resource, and we'll, if you send Michelle or you contact us, we'll send you a link to all this information. The document locator will identify insurance policies. You know how many things, insurance policies go to unclaimed funds because people aren't aware of them. Okay, so you want to make sure that you have everything documented. Who's your advisors? If something should happen to you, do they know who to call? What's in the safety deposit box? Passwords. Do you have a password list? What happens if someone wants to get into your account? Do they know the passwords? Where are they kept? I think it would be more difficult. You probably have to get paper documents. At least if they knew your passwords, they can see what mom had.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why these documents are so important, safety deposit boxes, you know, password listing, you know, people that were part of the military. So this document is actually something that you should be considering to fill out. Same thing with this personal balance sheet and net worth. It'll tell you how much you're worth. And every tax season, after you do your tax return, you can find out how much you're worth because you have all the 1099s there. You know what your balances are. So it's a perfect time to complete these things. Here's in this.
I'm managing my uncle's estate, which is passed away at Archer. So hard.
Oh, it is. If you don't have this organized, then I promised myself and I promised my kids that I would do this. You know, besides keeping going through all the boxes of stuff I have. If you have any questions, email, phone, you can call me, let me know, send me an email. If you want this, right, if you want some information, if you want something, these information, these documents, let us know, and we'd be happy to give them to you. Any questions? Okay. Hopefully you guys